welcome back to the second half of the show. I am here with Honorable Faith Nakut, the woman member of parliament for Napark District. Honorable, you have made very interesting claims here about the distribution of resources, and I think that we need to get down to the area, the Karamoja sub-region, and why this scandal was able to unfold in this region. I know there have been very many other scandals, but then looking at this particular scandal, do you think that the politics, the local politics between the area leaders and the MPs was enabling for this scandal to actually happen?
Well, it is true, we have our own local politics. We have chairmen, district chairpersons. Well, we also have LC3 chairpersons, that layer of leadership. And it would be wrong for me to say that we don't have issues. We have our local issues. But on this matter, we are in solidarity together to see that our people get the justice. Yes, there were instances where we couldn't be listened to, and then the minister could choose whom to work with, whether to work with the chairman LC5 or to work with the members of parliament or to work with the LC3 chairman. That was there.
Why was that?
I mean, you know that if you are very smart in your game and you want to rule people, you first confuse them.
You're talking about the divide and rule
method? Of course, you divide and rule. You first confuse them and then you loot properly. Gladly, on this matter of the loot, we are all together. The LC5 chairman, the members of parliament, the LC3 chairman, all the layers of government within Karamoja, we are saying one thing: our people should get what they deserve. So she got it wrong.
So how did she do that?
Okay, there was an issue of the procurement of goats. And for us as members of the Karamoja Parliamentary Group, because at the time of requesting, of engagements with the president, I told you insecurity was there. It was just beginning, but it wasn't at its peak. By April, when these goats were procured, the insecurity, March, April, the insecurity was at its highest. That's when we had lost 3,000 lives. And so we saw the distribution of goats at that particular time as something that would cause more insecurity to the people who would receive. We advised the minister that procurement could go on, but the distribution be delayed a little for 3 months or so as we observe the security situation. Because insecurity in Karamoja is insecurity of livestock, and then the process, people are killed. So that was our advice. And then she said, no, it can't happen. She refused to take the advice of the Karamoja Parliamentary Group and decided to go ahead and work with our district chairman. And he said, it's okay, you can now. After all, it is the very beneficiaries to get. And then the distribution happened of goats. That was the rift we had on the timing. We asked them to hold on the goats a little, and they couldn't listen to the members of parliament from the region. They said, okay, let me now work with the district chairman. She chose that option, divide and rule. In the process, the goats were distributed. Some goats were stolen.
When was that?
June, July. The launch was in June. Yes. Some goats were stolen. A few goats were stolen. Majority of goats died. Actually, if they had taken our idea of holding the goats, we would have saved some money of government, because then we would have known that the suppliers are having goats that are genuine, that are not sick. But now, in the process of trying to hurry and bypass and refuse to take advice, goats were distributed, majority of the goats died. Our people received air in the name of God. So now we have 26 billion shillings lost. You've said you've supplied, and there is nothing. You people are poor at the same. People are vulnerable in the same manner. So now you just can't imagine the failure to listen. And that's the same minister who is saying that she needed guidance. From who? If she refused to take small guidance from members of parliament from the region, now which guidance did she need? On iron sheets, for instance.
Of course, to her defense, she was working with the area leadership, and that was guidance in a way. But what could have been the incentive for these local area leaders to work with her, knowing that they have bypassed the member of parliament in those regions?
I think they were not aware. Let me assume they were not aware.
Yes, they were not aware.
They were not aware that we had had an engagement which we did not work.
Okay. Yeah. So there is no...
But at least the minister was aware of our perspective.
Yes.
Yeah.
I think that's quite an interesting complication there, because then, like you're saying, there was some mismatch in the information that the local area leadership was receiving, and therefore that was able to happen. We have heard that the Parliamentary Committee on Presidential Affairs is going to the ground to find out more information about this scandal. Are you confident that information coming out of the different places they are going to visit, or the leaders they are going to be interacting with, or the people, is going to keep the MPs together in one voice on their response about this scandal, and how they have stood on calling the minister to resign? Isn't there any other information about how this scandal could unfolded? Are the MPs completely innocent about the scandal?
At least I am confident that the committee that is going on ground will get full facts, and our people will get full facts. I told you that on this one, even if we have our other regional politics and our differences, on this one we are united as leadership for Karamoja and even our people. So there is no worry on that.
There's no worry on that. And Honorable, again, about the local leadership and how this scandal has been able to unfold. You're talking about the divide and rule method, and that the local leaders did not know what was going on. Why wasn't there information passed on from you, the MPs, to the leaders? Because you could already see that there was a problem. It was already past the period within which this relief or affirmative action should have come to your region.
There was information passed on to the local leaders, actually to even our people. But because there was a syndicate, especially on the goat supply, yes, we suffered resistance from home.
At some point
we had some people instigating our community members to say that it is you, the honorable members, who don't want us to receive these things. They didn't understand us. Now you see the loss. I wish they had listened to the people they elected.
Again, earlier on, when the honorable Dr. Mary Goretti Kitutu was appointed minister of your region, the Karamoja sub-region, there was still resistance from some area MPs who did not like the fact that she didn't come from that region. And they witch hunting her in these particular circumstances?
No, they are not witch hunting her. Yes, indeed, there was resistance. We would have preferred a model where you have one person from the region. This ministry has two people, one person from the region and another from another region. But that doesn't mean that Ugandans cannot serve in the ministry of Karamoja. They had served before. We have had ministers from other people from other regions as ministers of Karamoja, and they did a good job. But we thought at that time when we published a press statement on our appointment, we thought that given the season, you know, insecurity was just beginning when we got elected. Insecurity was biting, and the new dynamic of the insecurity in Karamoja. So it's not even of the past. It's not something you'd read books to understand. And that's why we thought that having someone from the region would understand, would help guide, especially the contribution towards peace building. We needed somebody. But we had no choice but to work together with the ministers that we were given. It doesn't mean that because of that, we are now saying the people, the minister did bad. No, no, no. The beneficiaries have not received the iron sheets. That's simple as that. Any normal Ugandan, you don't need to be a Karamojong to know that the intended beneficiaries should receive what they deserve. You don't need to be a Karamojong. You just need to be a right-thinking Ugandan with some sense of integrity, with some sense of shame, so that you don't take what belongs to another person, you take to your mother. You just need that. You don't even need a PhD. So it is wrong to assume that the leadership of Karamoja is just fighting the minister. No, no, no. We have nothing to fight for when we are fighting, if it is fighting.
You have called for her resignation before all the facts can actually be found. You will remember that during the parliamentary committee hearings, she kept on saying, "I will give evidence off camera." And even her junior minister, Honorable Agnes Nandutu, kept on saying, "I was not aware about this." That means there's a lot of information that we don't know. Do you know why the junior minister is saying she's not aware and the minister wanted to give information off camera?
Well, the minister wanted to give information of the recipients of our donations off camera. She was specific on that. And the junior minister wanted to testify without the presence of our senior. And she did really testify how she has suffered in that ministry, being excluded from everything, having a supervisor who does not want to work with you, who odds information. So that is how the junior minister explained herself.
So indeed she was not aware about how the list came up of the beneficiaries that actually received the iron sheets, even though she also must have received some iron sheets. Did she receive some iron sheets?
She testified that she received 2,000 iron sheets on call. She was called to pick them when she did not request for them, just like other ministers were also receiving. We have asked for a resignation of the minister because we think that it is noble to do that when you have when this ugly thing is on your face, also to allow proper investigation happen. We've asked for resignation, but as it is now, the resignation seems to be the option she's willing to say, because she would have already tendered in the apology together with the resignation. Since she hasn't submitted in the resignation, it means she is saying, "Prove me guilty." And the committee is going to prove her guilty or innocent. Yeah, the evidences that are coming out clearly show that she should step aside. But we cannot force that.
Yes, yes, that's true. Because that has to come out of the investigations, and then you're going to have the committee make recommendations on what should happen and what have you. But how are the people of the Karamoja sub-region coping without all those interventions?
They are managing. They are managing their normal way. Okay, I did not tell you one other reason why we opted for iron sheets. Because we have filed a lot of reports, our disaster management committee reports of all our districts, every time there is a report, there is a village burnt down. And when a village is burnt down, you have identity cards of people, money, village savings boxes burnt down. So that's one reason we think that when you have a house that has iron sheets, you'll have valuables of a village protected. So we think that that would have helped solve part of the problem, but now it hasn't worked out. So right now,
what are the options? People are bitter. What options do you have?
People are bitter. People are annoyed. Mm. They are very, very bitter. Even they think that by me saying it is okay for the minister to apologize, they think that I have been bribed to accept that it is okay to apologize. They think I have settled for less. I have received several calls from our people who are saying, no, it's not just an apology we want. We want the iron sheets, the goats, and we want the minister to move away and let another Ugandan serve in that office. They think that they cannot trust her again with anything for the region. You remember, we have already, it's an affirmative action ministry. And so whatever is specific for Karamoja will come through that ministry. And if the people in you are supposed to serve do not trust you, which kind of intervention will you do? How will you even stand to address them? It's a ministry for mobilization, for mobilizing people to embrace government program, for mobilizing people for development. How will you stand to mobilize when they don't trust you? That's the problem. The trust has been lost.
Yes. How do you hope to move forward in case the report comes out and the minister is implicated? Because you know that she can choose to resign, but if she does not resign and the appointing authority has not removed her as minister for Karamoja, what do the MPs in your group hope to do about such a situation?
We will file essential motion if that situation happens. But we trust that the committee will do an excellent job.
Yes.
They will come out with recommendations, and those recommendations will guide us. And if the minister is implicated and is supposed to step down, step aside, and she doesn't do it, we will use our rights as provided for in the rules and in the constitution as members of parliament representing the region. And we will move essential motion, and we know that our colleagues will support it, because it's not just about Karamoja. It is about the integrity of a nation. It is in question. It puts everything at stake. If we say that this is how we should now operate, allowing this case to go without proper punishment means we have said it is official. When a cabinet minister does it, it's not compared to when a chief administrative officer does it. We will say it's not official. You can steal anything in Uganda. You can divert anything in Uganda and get away with it. And we don't want that for our country. We still love Uganda. We don't want that. So we will push whatever it takes for the minister to leave that office. If the president still likes her very much, he has a right to appoint her to another ministry.
How are you facing the local area leaders, the LC5s, that are having to answer yes to the community down there, but also can be a bridge between those people at the grassroots and yourselves?
We are one in this fight with the LC5 chairman. So far there is nothing to point that we are disagreeing. All we want now, as we speak, all we want now is for the goats, the iron sheets, to reach the intended beneficiaries. So there is no conflict. We've had meetings with them here in Parliament last week. Our LC5 chairmen were here. We've continued to engage with our platform, where we discuss what's going on, the progress in following up this case. We are together with our LC5s, with our mayors. We have two mayors in Karamoja. We are on top of this together.
So now we have a situation.
And the bridge to the people. Now the people are asking, what's going on? We don't know what to tell them. I don't want to tell them that your iron sheets are not there and you'll never get them. I don't want to tell them that. I have told them that we are pursuing. Because if I tell them, they may take the law in their hands, which is bad. the consequence of a statement from a leader that now there's nothing we can do. There's nothing we can do. Your things have been stolen. Those Karachunas who are targeted, those are criminal elements, by the way. People who have their guns, who are ready, who are using criminality to survive. And then you tell them that your things have been looted. No, I don't want to say that to the Karachunas back home. I tell them that we are working hard with our government to ensure that these things come to you. That's how we are facing it anyway.
So between you and them, there is this scandal that has ensued, and you are saying that whatever happens, the minister could get censured in this particular issue.
Yes.
And the people down there at the grassroots want action. Do you know if there is going to be another process within the ministry or the prime minister's office to have an intervention on this matter or to correct this situation?
I'm not quite sure whether the office of the prime minister will have another intervention to correct this situation. I cannot confidently assert that they do, but it is something they should. Actually, OPM should first of all try to clean their house. Because you know the things the minister said should only speak in camera, off camera, in confidence, points to the method of work within the office of the prime minister. We have also had another minister for disaster preparedness explaining his frustration within the office. So the whole structure of how we do work in the office of the prime minister, how we deliver services to Ugandans, if the office of the prime minister should do it anyway, it must be revisited. Otherwise, we will have these scandals reoccurring.
But talking about scandals reoccurring, this is not the first time scandals have happened in Karamoja.
Again, because of people who want to do it.
Why is it that these scandals have happened again?
People who want to divert, people who have the highest level of greed. I know we all have our levels of greed, but the highest level of greed is where you want to remove something of a poor person, of somebody vulnerable, something which is meant to create, imagine, for insecurity, for fighting insecurity. You don't even want to touch that because it's about life and death for somebody else. But if you don't have the shame not to touch that also, how do we call that? And people are there who do that, who are daring.
Then what should government do to bring this region at par with the rest of the regions in the country?
There are lots of things that
yes.
Government should do.
Mm.
Government should invest in affirmative action on education, strictly for Karamoja, because the fight against corruption requires having people who can have a say on what you're giving them. Having people who can say, you have delivered sick goats and I am not taking them. You need an empowered person who can do that. But our people, they even accepted sick goats, which died and even infected their other goats. Imagine the loss to the region. Poverty time is, I don't know how many times we have degenerated as a result of this supply alone. So investing in education is very key. As it is now, yes, we have secondary schools. We have primary schools, but not in every parish. Ensuring that our children access education is very, very key. We have, for example, in my district in Napak, we have children who walk 14 kilometers, 20 kilometers to the nearest school. And so you don't expect them to come to school every day because of access to a school.
And very tiring.
Yeah, and
it
very
could
tiring.
Be so, very tiring.
So you have those children who are going to grow up and they will continue to be abused by anyone. By criminals, by people. So they will not speak for themselves. They will not demand their rights. They will not know what is theirs. They will think that it is a favor to receive even a sick goat. So we need to raise a critical mass of people who can question things within Karamoja. That will help very much the development of Karamoja.
Now, apart from those that you've talked about, improving education in the region, Karamoja sub-region also faces a lot of drought, and that has been part of the problems as to the seasons of food that is grown in that area. And there could be other interventions that can be done in that area.
Yes, true. There are interventions like on food security. Yes. Yeah, on food security, we receive some rain, but it's not enough for, it doesn't spread across the year. And we receive some rain in a small season and it disappears. So you have a half of the year, a half of the year can be dry.
And so last year we had that situation where you had to call up the rest of Uganda
to support,
on the region's problems that were going on there. People were dying from hunger. Yeah. And how are you prepared to deal with it this time around before it even happens? Because you're talking about seasons that are
it's going to happen again.
Consistent
as
throughout
it is
the year.
Now, because last year there was a small harvest.
Yes.
Our people did not harvest that much. The acreage was small. The insecurity then, I told you, the item insecurity during cultivation time in March could not allow our people to cultivate. So they had nothing to harvest in August, a majority of the people. So as it is now, that crisis is still there. So for us to get out of it, we need to have to plant enough food to open up big fields and plant enough food and invest also in our livestock, so that they don't die. That's why I'm not happy for someone to bring sick goats to kill our other goats. Otherwise, those goats would have multiplied and our people would sell when they feel hungry. So the entire livestock sector and food crop sector, we need to invest in it now so that next year there will be no starvation. This year there will be starvation because there was no harvest last year. So we need to invest in it. We receive water, but it all flows because of the terrain. It all flows to the lowlands and the low belts in Teso. Our majority of our dams are already silted, so they need to be desilted. I have asked the ministries to support in desilting. There is no response so far. I wish that they would listen in, that we desilt those dams so that when it rains, our rain is expected at the end of this month or in April. When it rains, we have some water reservoirs that people will use during the dry season to cultivate even their vegetables, so that we don't see people dying of starvation. So there is still a lot of work to be done.
Yes, a lot
and
of
I
work.
And I expect Ugandans not to be tired. When I call on you to support our people, even when I don't call on you, now you know that there are Ugandans who need to be supported.
Okay. Honorable, we are concluding this show, and I would like to hear your parting shots on this scandal and the report that is being prepared by the Presidential Affairs Committee.
We have confidence in the committee and the committee leadership that they will do an excellent job. They have proved it over time that they can do an excellent job. We will rely on their report. On this issue of the fight against corruption, I want to ask all Ugandans to continue in the struggle to fight against corruption. And I have trust in our president, the President of the Republic of Uganda, that he will take appropriate action, especially on this matter. Because like I told you, it sets a precedence, and a very bad precedence, that you can divert anything, you can get government supplies and take to your people and they begin selling them and it is okay with it. It's not okay with it. We are not okay. Uganda cannot be okay with that kind of malpractice. So let this case of Iron Sheets open our eyes on the fight against corruption. Let it be an example that we can be determined on one thing and we achieve it. Of course, I expect a deeper investigation on the affirmative action ministries, their relevance, what they do, how they deliver, whether they are really working, ensuring that those ministries are working to bring those regions at par with the rest of the countries. Not only Karamoja, we have other ministries, affirmative action ministries. I expect a new way of work that we will together be focused at how our actions affect the daily lives of ordinary Ugandans. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Honorable. That was the checkpoint this week. We have been speaking to Honorable Faith Nakutz, the woman member of parliament for Napark District. And the fight against corruption rages on. We will be waiting to see how the committee of parliament, the presidential affairs committee that is investigating this matter, concludes it. And if indeed we still do have some morals to talk about. Thank you very much for watching. I am Vivian Kamsimi.